load backstage and get to ride over with you, right?
That's right, you're riding with me.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, I'm going to take you
okay,
over,
cool.
right? Okay?
Should be nice.
Cool.
Let's head to the car.
This is our car
Excellent.
Right here?
Awesome.
Dong. This is our car?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Bye-bye. Right on, what you do? Did you do what you just did? What I just did.
Were there any songs that you weren't able to do in the show that just for time or?
Well,
that you
The
really
Greatest Love.
To... Yeah.
You know, it's such a, it's like I'll Always Love You.
Right.
So I had to toss it between the two of them mm-hmm. and I'll Always Love You won.
Yeah? Flip the coin or?
Well, no, I looked at this record stats.
Okay, there you go. Because I remember you.
And she won.
You have said before.
Sissy's Baby, Whitney Elizabeth Houston, garnered 6 Grammy Awards, 22 American Music Awards, 16 Billboard Music Awards, 28 entries into the Guinness World Records, and 14 World Music Awards. These, which when combined with her various other accolades, make her one of the most awarded female vocalists ever. Referred to by many as The Voice, how and why did the daughter of a city administrator and a renowned session and gospel singer become a legend? Born August 9th, 1963, in Newark, New Jersey, to John Houston and Emily Sissy Houston, Whitney Elizabeth Houston grew up in a middle-class Baptist family. She received her start singing in the New Hope Baptist Church Choir in Newark with the hymn, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah. She got her start professionally singing at 12, and by the age of 14, she was providing backing vocals for various artists. Throughout the early 80s, she modeled, sang in a club act with her mother, and provided further backing vocals on projects, until in 1983, she was spotted by Gary Griffith, a talent scout and a representative for Arista Records. And after Arista president Clive Davis heard her sing, she was approached with a worldwide record deal. She would sign with Arista. Her debut album dropped on Valentine's Day, 1985, and just 8 days later, the single, You Give Good Love, was released. The album, despite debuting on the Billboard Hot 200 at number 166, was an international smash, charting within the top 10 album charts in Australia, Austria, Canada, Finland, Germany, Japan, New Zealand, Norway, South Africa, Sweden, Switzerland, the United Kingdom, and of course, her motherland, the United States. Critics fawned at the mouth over the body of work, praising its romantic innocence and calling it some of the loveliest pop singing on vinyl. It was nominated for 4 Grammy Awards, 6 American Music Awards, and 2 MTV Video Awards. She was named the top artist by Billboard, the top black artist by Billboard, and her album was named the top pop album of the year. It was the best-selling debut by a solo artist ever. Anchored by singles Saving All My Love, How Will I Know? And greatest love of all. All of which were number one pop hits. Whitney Houston signaled the arrival of pop's new starlet. On May 2nd, 1987, the first single from her sophomore effort was released. Despite mixed critical reception, the single was an international smash, charting in over 20 countries. As that single climbed the charts, in June 1987, her second body of work, Whitney, was released. It debuted at number one on the Billboard Hot 200, and just like her previous album, the first singles, Didn't We Almost Have It All? So emotional. Where Do Broken Hearts Go? And I Wanna Dance With Somebody, all peaked at number one on the pop charts. It would be 3 years until she released another body of work, one that was markedly different than her first releases. A difference clear on the album's lead and titular single. The single was an international chart topper and peaked at number one in the States. The album, I'm Your Baby Tonight, followed in November 1990. The next single, All the Man That I Need, was also a number one pop hit. It was only natural that after a series of international hits that she translate her talents to the grandest of mediums.
So, are you a good actress?
I don't know, am I?
Did I you think see you the are. Film? I saw the movie last
did
night.
Did you like it?
I did.
Did you think I was a good actress?
Yes, I did. Yeah. Would I lie to you?
Yeah.
No, I did.
You might.
It was a script originally intended for Diana Ross and Steve McQueen, The Bodyguard, that would introduce the world to Whitney, the movie star. The actress. It tells the story of Rachel Marin, a singer and actress receiving death threats at the height of her career. Although not receiving critical acclaim, it was a box office hit, becoming the seventh highest grossing film of 1992. The lead single from the soundtrack, I Will Always Love You, was an enormous success, both in the States and overseas. The song alone won over 10 accolades. The next single to feature Houston, I'm Every Woman, was released while I Will Always Love You still topped the charts in early 1993. I'm Every Woman, too, became a top 10 pop hit. The next single, I Have Nothing, was also a top 10 pop hit. And the next two singles, Run to You and Queen of the Night were modestly successful. Overall, The Bodyguard soundtrack was a chart topper in over a dozen countries and remains one of the best-selling soundtracks ever. Thanks to The Bodyguard, Whitney swept at the 1993 Billboard Music Awards, winning 11 awards in one night. The greatest love. She embarked on a world tour and was the first major singer to perform in South Africa post-apartheid.
The greatest love of all.
This fall, 20th Century Fox invites you to meet four incredible friends.
In 1995, her second film, Waiting to Excel, was released. She starred alongside Angela Bassett, Loretta Devine, and Lila Roshan in a film that chronicled four women and their man troubles. The soundtrack, which featured a myriad of female powerhouse vocals, featured another hit for Houston, Excel, the Shoop Shoop song. It was only the third single in Billboard history to debut at number one on the pop charts. The next two singles, Count on Me, which featured CeCe Winans, and Why Does It Hurt So Bad, were modestly successful on the pop charts.
In charge on the set.
You look back, Barry. Keep going back.
Denzel Washington co-stars with Whitney and plays the part of an angel sent down to save a struggling church.
In 1996, with the release of only her third film, Houston was the highest paid black actress in Hollywood. The Preacher's Wife, a remake of a 1948 Cary Grant film in the heartfelt story of a preacher, his declining congregation, and his wife's singing talents. Of course, the soundtrack became the best-selling gospel album of all time. Anchored by top 10 singles, I Believe in You and Me, as well as Step by Step and My Heart is Calling.
It's better than any royal ball. It's the premiere and party for Cinderella.
She continued her film career in November 1997 with the television movie Cinderella, where she portrayed the fairy godmother.
For a plain yellow pumpkin to become a golden carriage, impossible. for a plain country bumpkin and a prince to join in marriage.
The updated version featured a black Cinderella, handpicked by Houston, Brandy
Great.
Yes.
It's great.
What I'm curious about, what do you think of her?
What do I think of her?
Yes.
I don't think of her.
In 1998, following years of comparisons between the two, she and Mariah Carey recorded When You Believe for the soundtrack of The Prince of Egypt. Despite the combined star power and intense promotion it received, the single only peaked at number 15 on the pop charts. Despite this, Whitney's first non-soundtrack album since 1991, My Love Is Your Love, in 1998, was a success. Anchored by Heartbreak Hotel, which featured Kelly Price and Faith Evans. It's not right, but it's okay. And My Love Is Your Love, all of which charted within the top five of the pop charts. In 2000, she released a greatest hits compilation. Two singles, If I Told You That, Could I Have This Kiss Forever? On September 17th, 2002, the lead single for her next release, What You Looking At, was dropped. Despite not nearly reaching the heights she attained just 4 years earlier, she still appeared in overseas charts. And its next two singles, One of Those Days, tried as she released a holiday album, which cracked the top 50 of the Billboard Hot 200. She would not release another body of work for 7 years, that is, until 2009's I Look to You. The singles I Look to You Million Dollar Bill were modestly successful. A passion project of hers, a remake of the 1976 film Sparkle, came to life in 2012. With Houston playing Emma, the mother of three singers whose ambitions clash with her strict teachings. Sadly, just 6 months before the film's theatrical release, tragedy struck.
Why should I feel discouraged?
Singer Whitney Houston, one of the greatest voices of our generation, has died. The singer Whitney Houston, 48 years old.
Should the shadows come? Lord, why should my heart?
February 11th, 2012 is a day that I am sure most watching this video remember. It is the day that Whitney Houston left to be with the ancestors. Rather than focus on the fodder that filled the news stations and tabloids well over a decade ago, I would rather focus on why she is a legend, despite her all too human shortcomings. I mentioned earlier that Whitney was Sissy's baby.
Our memories alone can get us through. Just think of all the days of me and you.
I meant this in both the literal and musical sense, for there would be no Whitney without Sissy. She taught Whitney how to sing, in other words, showed her how to effectively use her instrument. Elizabeth Sissy Houston is a legend in her own right.
I told her, I said, write a book and tell all.
Threefold for her work with the Drink Art Singers within the gospel field during the late 50s and early 60s, for her work with the Sweet Inspirations providing backup vocals for a myriad of artists from the 60s onward, which I might add consists of more than just oohs and ahs.
The Sweet Inspirations would be called in, and Sissy would come up with a background vocal arrangement.
Most of it came from Sissy Houston and the girls.
And for giving the world our video subject. Every early news segment done on Whitney Houston points out her early career as a model, Sissy being her mother and Dionne being her cousin.
Her mother is Sissy Houston and her cousin is Dionne Warwick. Whitney also models.
The implication being that her fame could be accredited to them and that a modeling career also gave her a leg up. It's an implication that she dispelled without ever having to verbally refute anything because of her talent. We'll be making love the whole night through. So I'm saving all my love. Yeah, I'm saving all my love. Yes, I'm saving all my love for you. When we think of musical legends, we think of those with broad international appeal, and Whitney had that in abundance.
Now I know where do broken hearts go? Can they find their way home?
Arista Records ensured that foreign audiences knew exactly who their new starlet was, releasing EPs, singles, and having her do interviews exclusively in countries like Japan, the United Kingdom, and Germany. This was to build a base for her in those respective countries and would not have been possible if her music and sound didn't have broad appeal.
Tell me, are you going through any changes? Time seems like it's passing you by. Just believe that love will find.
Her first album can definitely be described as pop-heavy or musically conservative, giving audiences only a hint at the vocal prowess that lurked beneath heavy synths and overwrought ballads. A 1985 New York Times article describes singles Saving All My Love and You Give Good Love from her debut as unremarkable commercial ballads made extraordinary by her fire and steel voice, which helps them transcend romantic cliches to become hymns of faith in a love that goes beyond the secular. By 22, her debut had sold more than any album by such legends as Donna Summer, Aretha Franklin, and Diana Ross. And if it ain't nothing broke, why fix it? So thus, her second album followed this formula. And critics did not mince words in pointing it out. One Rolling Stone review is particularly painful, stating, "On one hearing, it's easy to dismiss Whitney Houston's new album as overcalculated, hollowed out pop product, so suffocated by professionalism that only the faintest pulse of soul remains. But after several listens, it's nearly impossible to dislodge Whitney from your brain. Like Houston's debut, this is a mess of an album that succeeds in spite of itself." The sales were through the roof. The backing of a major label like Arista, as well as the personal backing of its president, Clive Davis, meant no matter what she did, it was going to be pushed with all of Arista's might. As it became abundantly clear that she was not going anywhere musically, she branched out to film, following in the footsteps of Diana Ross, to whom she was actually compared to some.
Was Diana Ross someone whom you felt you were like?
Think it over.
No, never. No, I had influences. I mean, I had people that I could look at in my own home. My mother. I wouldn't have to look at Diana Ross.
Think it over.
Had she not did The Bodyguard, we wouldn't have I Will Always Love You, I Have Nothing, or I'm Every Woman. Had she not did Waiting to Excel, we wouldn't have Excel, the Shoop Shoop song, and so on and so forth. It was genius, really. All she had to do was play herself, sing a few songs, and boom, superstardom. She walked into the new millennium a superstar. Anything she touched turned to gold. That is, until it ceased. By 2002, it was clear that negative media attention concerning her rocky marriage with Bobby Brown,
tell Bobby we said hello, okay?
I will, love. Take care, bye.
And a battle with substance abuse all took a toll on her. And then, of course, there's the infamous ABC interview where Diane Sawyer tried to coerce Whitney into admitting the truth concerning substance abuse by shoving a photograph in Whitney's face.
Do you really know?
No, you know.
Thank you.
Tell me what you're looking at.
Thank you.
Kick off my shoes and relax my feet. Hit the kitchen, grab a bite to eat. It's been one of those crazy weeks, and I gotta do something special for me.
So for the following 7 years, the voice went silent. When she did make appearances, such as this one at the BET Awards in 2005, it was clear that she could still captivate an audience with or without singing. This brings me to my last point. Whitney sang until the very end. Life in the public eye was not pretty nor easy for her, but as she said herself, Whitney was not built
to break.
So, vocal training by one of the most experienced vocalists of the 20th century, Arista's devotion to making her a global figure, a film career, and perseverance in abundance. That is why Whitney Houston is a legend.